Okay, so this is AASHTO T310, in-place density and moisture content of soils. So this is testing for moisture and density of soils in the field with compacted embankments. When you come in to certify, this is the gauge that you're going to use. What you need to know about this gauge, it is a dummy gauge. In other words, there is no radioactive source in this gauge. So when you come in to certify, you don't need to worry about radiation safety training with this particular gauge. So what, for this test, to start, again, a couple of steps that you need to verbalize to us before you begin the test first is a nuclear density gauge has to be calibrated at least yearly. We need to know that before we go out in the field and start testing, that it's been calibrated. Second, when you go out into the field, your gauge has to be turned on and left on to warm up at least 10 to 20 minutes before you begin using it in the field. And you have to do a standard count with your gauge. To do a standard count, you will take your standard block and place it in the field at a suitable test location where you're going to be taking your nuclear density tests. And to position the gauge on the block, you need to know the proper position on the block. This side of the gauge needs to be up against the metal base plate for the standard block, and then you will take your standard count. So that is standardizing your gauge, calibrating your gauge, and now we're ready to talk about testing. So your test site in the field. Again, you'll need to verbalize this to us. You need to be at least 30 feet away from any other radioactive source. The only other radioactive sources that you should have on your project would be other nuclear density gauges. You need to be 10 feet away from any large objects, trucks, dozers, construction equipments. If you are testing in a trench or adjacent to a wall in a cut section, you need to be at least 6 inches away from that trench wall or from that cut wall. And now we'll talk about prepping your test site. You will use your base plate and create a smooth, flat, and level surface that is large enough for the footprint of your gauge. You don't want to be compacting the soil with your base plate, just enough to make it smooth, flat, and level. If there are voids in your test site, you can use native material that passes the number 4 sieve and sprinkle it in to fill up voids no more than 1/8 of an inch deep. And again, you'll smooth those out and level them with the base plate. Once you have your test site prepared, for method A, you only need a space large enough for the footprint of your gauge. For method B, you need a space that's large enough for your gauge to be rotated either 90 or 180 degrees. So you need to prepare a larger footprint for method B. You're then ready to pound your hole. The probe depth for your gauge needs to be at least 2 inches below the lift thickness that you're testing. So if we're dealing with a 4-inch lift, then we need to pound a hole at least 6 inches deep for testing. If we're dealing with a 6-inch lift, then we need to pound a hole at least 8 inches for testing. So you're going to pound your rod into the ground 2 inches beyond your test depth. For this example, I'm demonstrating a 4-inch lift just because of the thickness of our soil tub here. So I pounded this down 6 inches. You then carefully remove it. We will remove our base plate, and we have our hole in the ground. We will take our gauge in the field. The ideal method is to put your gauge exactly where your base plate was and remove your rod, put it into the hole. But we understand in the field, some folks like to expose the rod briefly and then place it into the hole carefully. You then lower your gauge to the test depth that you want, making sure that your hole does not collapse or cave when you insert the rod. And then we need to seat the gauge. That source rod needs to be in contact with the side of your borehole that you did with your test rod. To seat the gauge, you're going to pull it and make sure it is seated against the side wall of your borehole. Then we need to check and make sure that the gauge is level. So check the corners, make sure it's not rocking when you're pushing down on the corners, because we don't want any voids beneath the gauge. That'll negatively impact your test results. So method A, we'll start our test. Method A is going to be 2 1-minute tests. So we take our first test. We record the wet density and the moisture content. We then leave the gauge exactly as it is. And boom, we start a second test, 1-minute test. We will record the wet density and the moisture. Your wet densities for method A need to be within 2 pounds per cubic foot of one another for it to be a valid test. Otherwise, you have to do it over. You will then average your moisture and your densities, your wet densities. For method B, you will do a 1-minute test. And again, you will rotate your gauge 90 or 180 degree. And when you rotate your gauge, you then need to reseat it against the wall of your borehole, and again, check that it is level and check that it's not rocking, and you will then do a second 1-minute test for method B. Those wet densities need to be within 3 pounds per cubic foot of one another. And again, you will average your moisture content and your wet densities. When you're completed with your test, you can extract your source rod, put your gauge away, and you'll then take a shovel and excavate a minimum 9-pound sample from the footprint of where your gauge was to the depth of the lift that you tested. You will place that sample into a sealed container and bring it back to your soil lab. And at a minimum, you will want to verify the moisture content of that material against the moisture content that was recorded by the gauge. At a maximum, you may end up pounding either a 1 point from this material or possibly a full Proctor curve so that you can compare the results of your nuclear density gauge to a new Proctor curve. Once you have that moisture content from the lab and you have your average moisture readings from the gauge to calculate your dry density and get your percent compaction in the field, if the lab moisture is more than 1% different than what your average gauge moistures are, you will use your lab moisture content for your calculation of dry density and to get your percent compaction. If the laboratory moisture content is within 1% of what the gauge average was, you can use the gauge moisture content for those calculations of dry density. And then once you have your dry density determined and your moisture content, you will then compare those results to a Proctor curve to get your percent compaction and to see what range your in-place field soil is to your optimal moisture content. So that concludes AASHTO T310. We'll move on to the next procedure.